Good morning.
So this tutorial is trying to explain the importance of causation and causality in the analysis of massive datasets. And so the summary is simple. The first part is why should we care? And then what can we do? So for me, this started about 4 years ago by some random chance. I find myself working in Microsoft Ad Center on the little ads that are on the search engines. Well, it was quite an interesting position because it didn't work very well at the time. So let me first take this example. And this is just an example, and we're going to try to show why this is an important topic. So you start with a system where you have advertisers who enter bids, users who enter queries, and some placement engine that decides which ads to show and what price to charge should the user click on the ad. Simple setup. Then when you look at it more closely, it gets more complicated because the ads you show are going to have an impact on what the user is going to do in the future. If you keep annoying the user with bad ads, it's going to go away or it's going to just learn to ignore them. It's also going to have an impact on the advertisers and their future bids. Because if they receive clicks from users who don't buy anything, or they don't receive enough clicks, they're not going to bid much. But this is not finished. You also have a lot of machine learning algorithms that take the data that's generated by the system, the list of queries, ads, clicks, prices, everything, you name it, you have it, and they're going to try to update the various models that drive the engine. And that's not it. You also have a lot of people, from 100 to 1,000, depending, who are just looking at this data, and they're trying to see how to make the system better. Data scientists and engineers, and they pretty much take the same data as the learning algorithms, and they affect the system in similar ways. So in a sense, they have a position in the system that's not very different from that of the learning algorithm. And that tells you two things, that machine learning is a misnomer. It's really about learning. Whether they're humans or machines, they really face the same problem. The second one is that you observe that the life of these people is very hard. And it's very hard because of the following. Suppose they change something here. They make a small change in the placement engine based on what they've seen on the data. Well, the change is going to change the ads that are shown, so it's going to change the data that's collected, so it's going to change what the machine learning algorithm is doing, which is going to change, again, what's going to be shown and the data that's collected in ways that might not be what they initially envisioned. At the same time, it's going to change what users are going to do and how they're going to change their behavior on the long term. And on the scale of a couple of weeks, it's going to change the future bid of advertisers. When they're going to change their bids, of course, it's going to change what the ad placement engine is doing, and then you get a complete loop. And the result is that you have a complicated feedback system that can be unstable in some cases, can start to oscillate, lots of things happen. And what they see in the data gives them very few hints about what's going on. So if I go on, I can look at the conceptual tools that are offered for solving this problem. So you have auction theory. Auction theory tells you something about the feedback loop with advertisers and how they're going to bid and everything. You have the contextual bandit theory in machine learning that addresses the learning feedback loop, the feedback loop for the machine learning algorithm. And there are very nice results for exploit. But the fact is that there is no systematic way to reduce the full problem with all its loop and all its complication to a combination of simpler problems that you can analyze with these theories. And people tried a lot of ad hoc combinations. They only go so far, and they're very complicated. Now, if you go back to the problem of the data scientist, well, you have to think they're half data scientists, half engineers. And how do engineers build things? And there is something that's been established for, pretty much one century, the way we build dishwashers, automobiles, airplanes, microchips, is that you start building something, then you measure relevant quantities and use calculus to try to understand what changes could do. And then when you find something that looks promising, you build it and you measure and you hope that what you measure matches what you calculated, otherwise something's wrong. And you do that again and again and again. So it's a combination of accurate modeling and pragmatism. Now, if you look at a system like this, Well, the approach of mining correlations in the big data and then doing statistical inference, basically applying Bayes' rules, doesn't work very well. Not only it fails to give a good quantitative result about what would we see if we make this or that particular change, but even fails to tell you whether a particular change is even good or bad. So what's happening here? So what's happening here is the confusion between a correlation and the outcome of manipulation. So if you have a correlation, it has a predictive value. For instance, you know that there is a positive correlation between the fact that it's raining and the fact that people walk with open umbrellas. If you see that it's raining, it's likely that people are going to walk with open umbrellas. And conversely, if you see that people walk with open umbrellas, it's likely that it's raining. This is predictive. This is machine learning. Now, we want to manipulate things. Okay, let's ban umbrellas. Will it stop the rain? Probably not. But if we manage to put a ceiling above the city, yeah, people will not have umbrellas. So you go from correlation that's something symmetrical to the effect of manipulation, which is basically one level zero of causation, that is asymmetrical and quite different. And so what are causes and effects? Causes and effects are tools to reason about the outcome of manipulations. It doesn't mean that all causal relation is something you can manipulate. Like if I say this and this happens because the Earth is round, you cannot manipulate the fact that the Earth is round. In fact, we say this because we do strings of reasoning that use as one step the fact that the Earth is round, and this string of reasoning operations lead to something that I can test and manipulate. So one has to understand the relation between correlation and causations. And this was written quite nicely in the 50s by Reichenbach. And he tried to answer the question that's fundamental in physics, is why two events that we observe are correlated. And there are some discussions. You can discuss this. This is more philosophy than mathematics. And let's take an example. So I took the ad, but it could be a recommendation system. Something is highlighted in red, event A. Event B, the user clicks. Suppose we see a correlation. And there are really three cases. Either A causes B, or B causes A, or A and B have a common cause. And the question is, what happens if we manipulate A, what happens to B? So let's look at the three cases. If A causes B, that's the easy case. Well, if highlighting the suggestion in red causes more click, if you make more suggestions in red, that's going to work. The second case, B causes A. Then manipulating A would have no obvious effect on B. But in fact, in that case, it's silly because we know that we cannot go against time. So often time disambiguates the order pretty well. But the really interesting case is A and B have common cause. Let's take an example. A third event that the particular user often clicks on ads. He just likes to click. And assume that there is something in your system that you don't even know about that favors red highlights when the user has features that describe that history of taking or suggestions or clicking on ads. So you see here, that's caused by the fact that this user likes to click, and this is the result of our little bug or thing in the program that we didn't think of. And we see a correlation between these two terms. And the question is, will we increase the click rate if we use more red highlights? Well, there are actually two cases. Maybe the user clicks because he likes ad and also because he likes red. So if you make more ads red, he's going to click more. And maybe the user clicks because he likes ad despite the fact that he dislikes red. So if you make more things red, he's going to click less. It's 50-50. So what did I have? I observe a positive correlation between these two events. But the real causation could be either way. So let's take an extreme case. This is what I see. No highlight, 12% click. Red highlights, 15% click. Good, that's my positive correlation. And this is my little bug that favors red highlights when the user is known to like suggestions. And here are my click rates. And what you see that whether the user likes red, likes ads or not, not showing the red is actually better. But when you accumulate these elements in the table, so 6 plus 18 is 24, 18 plus 182 is 200, same here, you see the inverse effect. It's called Simpson's paradox. It's a property of tables. Yes?
Just a quick question. Do you always assume that you know C to be true or C to be false?
The problem is that when we don't know C, there could be causes that are not observed. So here I'm taking an example where I can disambiguate the problem by identifying the event C, and then I can split between true and false and look at what's happening. In many cases, there is an event C, you have no idea what it is, it might not even be in your data. So the things that are going to be the problem are not the common causes you know you can identify, they're the common causes you didn't think of. And you cannot even think of these common causes because they're not even in your data. So what happened regularly in the ad placement system is that people would come with a nice correlation and say, well, can I do this to get this effect? And we had to bang our heads against the wall to understand why this was wrong. What was the common cause that would confound this observation and makes it wrong? And often the common cause is not even the data, you cannot prove it. So it's really a situation that's embarrassing because you know that something's not going to work because you start to understand the problem, and you cannot even prove it because the data is not actually in your data set. There is a common cause that you can posit because you understand the problem, but until it's measured, you have no way to know. And still, in your data, you have a positive correlation, and it could go both ways. It could be positive or negative effect. So one thing that's important to notice is that this is the fundamental problem, and the fact that I have 200 here doesn't change anything. It could be 2,000, 20,000, 2 million. Having more data is not going to make the answer correct. It's a fundamental problem that is such that the quantity of data is not going to save you. Maybe it's going to help you because you have more chances to have the common causes that's messing up your problem. But you have to find it. It's not an obvious thing. So I told you that when I was working with these ads, we had a lot of people coming, and eventually at some point I decided this is impossible. The question you're asking is wrong. You cannot say, I have a correlation, can I do this? This question has no valid answer on the basis of the data. Actually, yes. The question you want to answer is a question about manipulation. Would we observe a higher click rate if we applied this specific sense to the system? And that means modeling all the chain of causes and effects that are going to change the system in various ways in the short term, in the long term. And one has to bite the bullet. There is no other way. So the first observation is that if you want to ask a manipulation question, randomization is the cure. If you can do A and draw A randomly with dice, your dice, not something that comes from elsewhere in the system, you break this link here. And if you break this link here, you cannot have a common cause, known or unknown. So because the only cause of A becomes a roll of the dice, you know that this case C is not possible, and you're back to the cases that actually are simpler to analyze. So typical example that happens in medicine all the time is randomized drug testing. A patient randomly receives a drug or a placebo, and we compare the recovery rates. This is a way to say whether giving this drug to everybody is actually going to help everybody. And there are examples where people didn't do that and things went wrong. In terms of engineering, the approach is A-B testing or A-B trials. It's the same thing. You first formulate the question, will we observe a higher take rate if we apply this specific change to the suggestion logic? You design a randomized data collection experiment, which basically means split the user into groups, and apply one system for the first set of users, a second system for the second set of users, wait a couple months, and compare. Now, the problem is that this is slow. So the first thing is that you can do this, for instance, in search. Like, if you have a search engine user, the experience of a search engine user does not affect other users. Well, yes, it's first order good approximation. So we can safely apply different treatments to different users. So you have a bunch of users and a bunch of treatments and compare them and do statistics. Now, if you do this ad system, and you know, the ad system is nothing very complicated. If you have a recommendation system, it's exactly the same. It's just as complex. Well, it's difficult to isolate experiment in this. You have to make certain assumptions about, for instance, the time scale, that the advertiser feedback is going to have a time scale of a couple of weeks. So what you observe for a couple of days is meaningful. And then after that, something else is happening. Same on the user feedback loop, same everywhere. Now, the question is to go beyond A-B testing, because A-B testing is first formulate the question, then collect the data by designing an ad hoc experiment, which is slow. And you have all this big data thing in the New York Times that we're supposed to do. And it's the opposite. We want to achieve a high throughput. We want to collect the data first and then answer a multitude of manipulation questions, including questions that were not anticipated before. So we have a problem again. So the solution is to inject some random noise during the data collection and to sort it out later in the Cooper way. And that requires a lot of modeling and inference techniques. In fact, the contrast between these two methods is the contrast between two kinds of questions. No, we want a manipulation question is what happens if we do this? It's a conditional. What would we observe if we apply this specific change to the system? That's the first one. And that suggests, okay, let's try it, let's do it. Let's try this change, another change, try it in the system, collect the data and see. That's A-B testing. But what we want to do is the counterfactual version. Would we have observed a higher click rate if we had applied this specific change to the system when the data was collected? Which is a lot more complex because we didn't do it. So we used a system that was different, we showed ads that were different, and yet we want to know what would have happened if we had shown different ads, but we don't know how the user would react in that case. And the important thing here is that this is a tool for reasoning as well. This is an implication, and this is something else. Here, we can say we can do chains of application. We know that if we do this, we see that. If we do this, we see that, and therefore try to reason and see what the system is doing. But if we want to support this reasoning by data, which is what big data is about, we need to go to that particular mode. And it's a bit strange. So I have a puzzle for the audience. We know Boolean logic. If a formula B is false, then the formula A implies B is true. And A implies B is often interpreted as if A, then B. So here is a sentence. If we had performed action A instead of A prime, then we would have seen B. So the first part here, we had performed action A instead of A prime, is false. Therefore, all sentences of that kind are true. What do you think? What's wrong? First of all, is it wrong? Who thinks this is wrong? Okay. Well, but do you think that all sentences of that kind, if we had done this, then we would have observed this? Are all these sentences true? So, okay, if the antecedent is false, then the implication is true. Below, I show you a sentence that's a counterfactual sentence. And by definition, in a counterfactual sentence, the antecedent is wrong. We didn't do that. Therefore, it seems that all counterfactual sentences are true. And we know it's not true. We cannot reason if they're all true. I can give you another one, it's the contrapose. We know that if A implies B and B is false, then A is false. Okay, if we don't see B, does it mean that we didn't perform A instead of A prime? Not really, because maybe we changed something else too. So in fact, this has been studied quite extensively, and the answer, this is the wrong kind of calculus. So Lewis in 73 shows that Boolean logic is insufficient, and he proposed a set of axioms for counterfactual logic. That looks very complicated because counterfactual logic is something we do all the time. We think about this all the time. You know, just in our real life, we know that if I had opened the tap, then the water would have flowed. And we know that, and we can make reasoning with that with no problem. But it's not simple Boolean logic. And you have to think about the consequences, about probability theory. Probability theory is based on Boolean logic. And then all of events are mapped to sets and everything. And Bayes rule is about conjunction of events, it's an end. And statistical inference. So this is something very fundamental. Like for instance, when Pearl invent do calculus for causal inference, he's trying to find a replacement for Bayes rule that obeys the rules of counterfactual logic. So it looks very complicated, but in fact, it's not, because we do that every day. If you think about it, the counterfactual logic means that whenever you do something, so if you just do something Boolean, it's enough to know the truth values of every event. If you do counterfactual logic, you need also to know by which mechanism these truth values was attained, so that if you change, you need to be able to reconstruct what would have happened if you had changed something. So basically, it's a spreadsheet. In a spreadsheet, you have all these equations, and you keep trace, not only of the results, the truth value in the case of logic, but also of the mechanism. And this is what we have to do to model causation. So causal modeling and inference. The reason why we do this is because when we look at correlations in the data, we really have problems, and we would like to go faster than A-B testing and be able to use data collected in the past in order to make predictions that are useful. And what we're going to do is a spreadsheet. So as everybody knows, the spreadsheet has been invented by, at least in 1921 by Wright, sort of. And this is the case of ads again, because this is the example that's close to my experience. So you have the user intent, you have no idea what it is. You have queries, you have an ad inventory, and you have the code in yellow. The code selects ads, selects bids, and compute a bunch of scores, and decide which set of ads to show, decide prices, and the user might click, and you get click. And you can express all of these relations with formulas. And the formulas take the antecedent, the direct antecedent variables, and they also take a noise variable, which I assume is independent for each formula, because I want to do statistics, so I want to get things a bit noisy. And that's called a structural equation model. So what's important is that not all of these formulas are known. This is, in fact, a device to distinguish what is known from what is not. Like, if I know the analytic form of one of these formulas, knowledge, I know something. But I could just know that this formula depends only on some variables and not from other variables. And that's knowledge, too. So the lack of an arrow is knowledge. Now, if I manipulate something, for instance, I'm changing the code that computes the score, or I change the parameter of the statistical model that computes the score. It's just like changing a formula here. And I could do plenty of algebraic manipulations, which represent changes in the system, provided the graph remains acyclic. Now, the question is what to do with the things I don't know. And what I would like to do, and this is why I want to use data, is to replace knowledge of the exact form of an equation by statistics. And to do this, at the zero level of statistics, I need to have repeated experiments. So I need to do repeated isolated experiments. I don't want the outcome of one experiment to pollute my other experiment. And a way to do this is to say, for instance, that the exogenous variables, those that are not, do not appear on the left-hand side of my equations, the initial variables, follow a certain distribution. That's not going to change. When I say this, I make this assumption, what I'm saying is that the outcome of that experiment is not going to change that distribution. I assume it's a given. Maybe I don't know what it is, but I assume it doesn't change. So that allows me to define a little graph that represents my experimental unit. And they assume without feedback. For now, feedbacks are they're going to come back later, but to some extent. Now, when I have this, I can rewrite my system. I can say I have p of my exogenous variables, and x of the equations in the this model can be seen as probability of b given xv. And the random component is given by the nose variable. So I can write this. P of all the variables in my system, which I summarize by omega, is a big Markov factorization in terms of conditional probabilities. And that's a Bayes network, the Pearl 1988 Bayes network. I forgot to say something that in the ways to model causality, there are several ways. There is the model of potential outcomes of Rubin, and I'm following the route of Pearl for now. I'm going to diverge at some point, but right now I'm following the route that you see in the causation book of Pearl. Okay, fine. Not if you make a manipulation, that means that you change one of the factors. And if you change one of the factors, you get another Bayesian network. If you make an algebraic manipulation of the structural model by changing big parts of your system, you have another Bayesian network. But what you know that's important is that all these Bayesian networks share some factors. The things you haven't changed are supposed to be the same. So that's the construction that was done by Pearl in 2000. So what you have here in terms of machine learning is a transfer learning system on steroids. Each of these Bayesian networks can be seen as a different experiment with a slightly different system. But if you learn something on one of the systems, you're going to learn something on factors that are shared between systems. And you can transfer this knowledge. And it's something that happens all the time in physics. In physics, you can make a first experiment to measure the gravitation constant, another experiment to weigh the rock, and a third one to throw the rock. And using the results or things you learn on these two experiments, plus some reasoning rules that are the laws of physics, the laws formalized by Newton, you can start to predict where the rock is going to fall. So there is a simple way to do this, which is important sampling. So I manipulate my distribution. So I use the star to represent it, to represent a manipulated distribution. So my assumption is that I collect data under a first distribution, and I want to characterize what's going to happen under a manipulated distribution that's obtained by changing some of the factors. So if I have the expectation of a variable, let's say a click count, a click rate, in my collected data, the expectation is basically the expected click rate is the integral of all variables of the original distribution times some cost function. And what I want to have is the click rate under the manipulation, which is the expectation of the same cost function under the P star distribution this time. But if you assume that things are not zero, and I'm going to come back on this, you can just take multiply and divide by P, and then interpret this integral as an expectation with respect to the distribution P, approximate by a finite sum, and what you get is that you have to compute the empirical average weighted by the ratio of distribution. Now, what's nice is that these weights, they're ratios of Markov factorizations. And all the things that are common between the numerator and the denominator, they're just factorized away. So in the end, the only thing you need to know are the factors in P star not in P, and the factor in P not in P star. So if I go back to my initial manipulation, which was, let's say, to change the scoring system in some recommendation or ad placement system, well, I need to know what the previous scoring system used to do and what my new scoring system does. And also, because I have this ratio, I don't want these things to be zero. So they have to be randomized. So that tells us that in order to have weights that are reasonable, I want P to be non-zero where P star is non-zero. So I want to have collected data with non-zero probability in domains where P star is non-zero. What does it mean? It means that if the top graph, my data collection distribution doesn't overlap the distribution that the manipulated distribution, then my ratios are going to be very large or crazy or an infinity. I'm not going to be able to do anything. On the other hand, if I collect data using a rather large randomized distribution, and I want to predict what would happen if I use a narrow manipulation distribution, my ratios are going to be reasonable. I'm going to be able to make estimation. And so this is where this notion of randomized experiments connect with the notion of exploration and exploitation. If you want to make deduction about what will happen in a certain regime, you need to have collected data in a system that performs sufficient exploration to actually experience the system a little bit under this regime. And then you sort out things later by using important sampling. That's the level zero, at least. So now you want to compute confidence intervals, and I'm going to jump a little bit. Okay, confidence intervals. What you get is that the confidence intervals you can derive for the estimate, an estimate of that form, have basically two parts. And if you think of a confidence interval in normal statistics, you think of the law of large number. And so basically you expect your actual value to be in the middle of the interval. And the further away you grow from the interval, the less likely it's going to be. Here it's different. You have an inner confidence interval that describes whether you have explored enough. And inside this inner interval, you really have no clue. It could be anywhere. And beyond that, there is the kind of Gaussian-like tails that tell you the statistical part, which depends on how much data you have. So basically, if the inner part is too large, it means that the data collection was not exploring enough to answer this particular question. And there is not much to do. You can collect more data. It's going to give very little information about the question you want. So that's a hint that your data collection is insufficient to tell you about a particular regime. Now, if the outer interval is too large, it means that you must sample more. You just need to get more data. It's going to be OK. So maybe it's going to be more clearer with a practical example. So I go back to the ad placement problem. And you know, you have ads on the right, ads on the top. The ads on the top, they receive a lot more clicks, but they have the potential to annoy users a lot more. So you would like to limit their number. And there is typically a threshold on the score somewhere that's called the mainline reserve that decides whether ads are going to go on the top or on the right. And the question is, if you change this threshold, can you predict exactly what's going to happen, not only in terms of how many ads are going to be shown, but in terms of clicks, in terms of revenue, in terms of everything. So we run a bunch of experiments, collected something like 20 million auctions during the summer 2010. And on the data collection experiment, we applied a random multiplier to this threshold. So the threshold was moving between 1/2 and twice its nominal value. With 95% chances that there was just a log normal distribution. And we tried to predict what would have happened on the same system if the nominal value of the threshold had been reduced by, let's say, 18%. And in order to be able to verify, at the same time, we had another set of users who were hit by this exact system with 80% lower. So what you see here is the variation of the mainline reserve threshold and the variation of the average number of clicks per rate. So the blue thing here is the inner interval. That's the one that tells you about exploration. And you see that when you go too far away, you cannot say anything. The little line here is the outer interval, is statistics, and in that case, it's not too bad. So that's the data collection distribution, and that's the one about 80% lower. And what you see that if I take the curves that were extrapolated from the data collection distribution, I can predict quite precisely where my click rate would land if I reduce my threshold by 18%. And what you see here is if you collect the data without randomization at the same time. and you see not much change. And the reason that the system is far from optimal, you know, you randomize a parameter, well, sometimes it's better, sometimes it's worse, on average it's the same. If the parameter was optimal, of course you would lose, but you're so far from optimal because you never had a way to measure it properly. So you can do that for the revenue, and what you see that in the revenue you have a lot more statistical effects, and the reason is that a small number of ads have a very high prices, and therefore if you just look at the ads that define the revenue, you have a lot more noise in the system, and well, you can do plenty of analysis that way. But the nice thing about this is that this is not a single question experiment. You have collected data with some randomization on the mainline threshold. But what you can do now is say, suppose I change my mainline reserve, and for this cluster of queries, I'm going to use value A, and for that cluster of queries, value B. No problem. It's just changing the numerator of the important sampling. I can make my estimate, can be exact. So what I would like to show now is that so far, I defined something that's pretty much model-free. The important sampling works regardless of what the system is. Things simplify, I just need to know what I'm changing. But I know a lot of things about this system. I have a lot of causal knowledge about the graph. And I can use it to improve the confidence intervals. So the first example is that I can use it to reduce the need for exploration. Because users see only the set of ads we select. They don't see the scores. They don't see the prices. So I know that if I show the same set of ads, but the scores and the prices are different, the click rate is going to be the same because the click rate depends on what the user had in his head and what he sees, but not on the scores. So what you can do is do what I call a displacement of the weighting variable. So instead of computing the weight on the basis of the probability of the scores, you're going to integrate to do them on the basis of the probability of the slits by using integration. And when you do this, you get this kind of reduction. And that's just for one parameter. If you do something with many, many parameters, the gain is much larger. Because if you do something that changes a little bit the scores, but you show no ads anyway because it's below the threshold, you know that they're going to be zero clicks. Another thing you can see is that you can use a lot of variance reduction methods. Like, for instance, in the same day, you see in red and in gray the click rates of two variants of the system. And you see that you have a lot of variance that comes from the intraday variations. And the variance that comes from what the system does is very small. So the way to do it is to define a predictor that takes scores, slits, whatever, and you make a prediction that's known. It's a formula you know. It doesn't have to be even very accurate. And then what you're trying to predict with important sampling is the difference between the prediction and the actual clicks. If the prediction is any good, the variance of this term is lower, you're going to multiply it by this raw weighting ratio that can be larger than one, but what you multiply by the raw weighting ratio is much smaller than if you were to multiply everything. And that way you also gain a lot of things on the confidence intervals by basically using a lot of knowledge about what you would expect. What else can you do? Well, you can compute derivatives. Suppose you have a scoring model somewhere that has a bunch of parameters theta, and you would like to know what would be the variation of the click rate if you varied the parameter by a small amount. Well, you can compute these counterfactual click rates in theta, and in theta plus d theta, divide by d theta, and there is a way to do it directly, and you get a derivative. So you would say, this is strange because this selection of ads is a discrete problem. You're not going to show a mixture of that. You're going to show simply one set. So if the threshold raises above a certain level, you're changing the system by a discrete amount. But the randomization helps. It changes the system into a continuous system. What matters is no longer whether you do A or B, is how often you do A and how often you do B. So now you can use continuous mathematics. And that means, well, you can do optimization. Like, for instance, there was an idea that was suggested by Lae and McAfee in 2011, which is to multiply, to rank the ads by decreasing a product of bit times probability of the click to the power alpha with alpha less than one. And the idea is that because you cannot estimate the probability of click very well, using alpha less than one put more stress on the bit because maybe the advertisers know something we don't know. But then, of course, if you change alpha, you change the scale of the rank, so you have to change the thresholds, and then you can look at, in red, these are level curves that represent the variation of the average number of mainline ads. In gray, you have something that's the estimate variation of advertiser value, which is kind of a metric that tries to measure how much advertisers like the ads. And you can say that if you want to say, stay between 2% of the number of mainline ads you show, you should probably choose something around here. And you can do this not for everything, but in clusters of queries, and okay. Now you want to go back to the feedback loops. So let me give an example. Suppose you change a threshold that says whether an ad is relevant to a query using some relevance score that comes from somewhere in the system. This system is full of scores in all possible ways because lots of people try to do smart things. If you increase the threshold, you reduce the number of ads you're going to show. If you reduce the number of ads you're going to show, you're going to reduce the revenue in the short term. But in the long term, maybe users are going to like this better and click on ads more in the future. Also, advertisers might find that the users are more engaged and increase their bids, but they can also find that you show less ads and they get less clicks, so reduce their bids. So where it's going to go, you have no idea. So you can see this as a dynamical system, and you're changing parts of the dynamical system, you're trying to predict what's going on. But just like the weather forecast, it's very hard to do it on such a long period. In that case, you change the dynamical system and thousands of auctions per second are going to happen, and you know that there are going to be effects that are going to take weeks to materialize. So estimating the transient regime in something like this is in fact very hard. But if you can assume that you go to some equilibrium, you can do equilibrium analysis. Now you want to know not all the transient, but how the equilibrium is going to change if you change such and such parameter in your system. And that way you have two kinds of answer. You have the answer short term, that says what is the short term response to a particular change of a parameter in your system that you should be able to estimate, and what is the long term response, which could be different, and knowing both responses is useful to make good decisions. So you want to ask a question of the form, how would the ad placement performance metrics have changed if we had applied a small change to a parameter theta of the click prediction model long enough before the data collection period to have reached an equilibrium during the data collection period? It's a bit complicated. But in fact, and I don't intend to speak about this too long now, it's something that has been done in physics forever. And in that case, we use a method called a quasi-static analysis that's common in thermodynamics, and you can get a differential answer to these kind of things pretty well in a nice way. So I'm going now to my last section, which is about discovering causal relations. And I should say that in my work, I was assuming that the graph of causes and effects was pretty much known. In many of the mining problems, you want to discover the causes and effects. You want to discover causes and effects because we know that causal relationships have value for us. And they have value for us because they help us making predictions about the outcome of actions we could take. And what I would like to do is oppose two scenarios. The first one is to reconstruct. I'm going to assume that the data is generated by some structural equation model. And the first one is try to reconstruct the causal graph from scratch. Is it possible? And the second one is look at whether we suppose we know something about the causal graph, can we refine it? Can we make it better? So reconstructing a model from scratch. Well, we assume the data samples are generated by a structural equation model. But we might not see all variables. There might be a lot of variables that are not observed. And then, any correlation I observe could have a common cause that's not observed. So I'm stuck. And in fact, this is just a take on Descartes' deceiving God. If God is deceiving, he has his own causes and reasons. But he manipulates what we observe to make us do something else. No way. There is, however, a glitter of hope that comes from an algorithm, the PC algorithm that was invented by Spiertes and Al in 2000. So relies on a bunch of assumptions. The first one is that all common codes are observed, which is a good thing. That the data is sufficient to identify all conditional independence. So the idea of the algorithm is that you take a lot of data and you identify all the conditional independence patterns between variables, and you try to construct a graph that's consistent with this conditional independence pattern. And you need a third assumption, which is that the observed probability distribution is faithful. That means there are no causes that cancel exactly, and that every causal relation has a trace in the correlations. And then there is a quite amazing algorithm. It's a bit costly and everything, but its existence is already amazing, that can recover a structural equation model that's causally equivalent to the one that generated the data. Alas, the assumptions are not realistic. All common causes of observed variables are observed. How do we know this? How do we test this? We don't know. But there is sufficient data to identify all conditional independences. This is statistically difficult, but we know how to do. And the last one, the observed probability distribution is faithful. There are no causes that cancel exactly and do not show in the correlation. Well, if you remember your physics classes, there is this idea of equilibrium, which is that action and reaction are exactly equal and opposite. They cancel exactly. And this is why I have the little tree here, you know. The thing is that if you have an equilibrium, there are causal relations you cannot discover unless the system is put slightly off equilibrium. So if you take the apple in the tree, there is gravitation that pulls the apple, and there is the stem that holds the apple. Nothing moves. Now, if the stem rots, the apple falls. If Newton is under the tree, he's going to think, oh, something was actually pulling on the apple even when the apple was not moving. And that's the realization that there is actually a causal relation that was hidden by an equilibrium. So now let's look at the other thing, refining an existing causal model. So I'm just going to give a couple ideas. I told you at the beginning that a structural equation model is just a way to represent what is known from what is not known. So I could have a function somewhere in my spreadsheet that's not known. And what I would like to do is use data to learn that function. That reduces to supervised learning on data that I collect by answering the question, what would y have been if we had manipulated x1, xn? So basically to do this and discover, for instance, the fine structure of f and whether there are intermediate variables and do feature selections and maybe discover something. To do this, you have the same requirements as those we had for the inference. You need some isolation assumption, repeatable experiments, which is not obvious when you have complex feedback loops. So you have to... You need a randomization assumption. You need to say that there are some source of randomness that affects x1, xn in known ways, and that this randomness is independent from everything else so that you can eliminate common causes. So you could assume it or you could know it, but depending on whether you assume it or know it, you'll have to verify later on. And the thing that's important is that the stronger the existing model, the more you can use these tricks that improve the confidence intervals, and the more likely you are to actually find something else. So somehow, the bag of causal relation is the more you have, the more you're likely to find new ones. Now, this is not enough, because when I assume a structural equation model, I'm already assuming an ordering of my variables, because I said that modifications should be acyclic, and basically there's an ordering of time. But when we don't observe all variables, we never know whether things, time ordering can be very difficult to do. So there is another observation that's quite recent, is that causation leaves footprints in the distributions. So if you look at variables that have that are binary, it's not very, very clear. But if you look at a variable that are continuous, so you have variable X and Y, and they're connected by some nonlinear relationship, has to be nonlinear. X is uniform, and if X is uniform, Y has a little kink like this because of the nonlinearity. And now my question is, Well, is it, what's the causal direction? Is it that y is f of x or that x is g of y? Well, if you say y is f of x, it seems reasonable. If you want to believe that x is g of y, you have to believe that by some random chance, the kinks in that distribution happen to fall exactly where you have the non-linearities in these non-linear relations. And how likely is that? It's a coincidence. And how much do you believe in coincidences? You have to be careful, because equilibrium is something that generates coincidences. But still, it's a hint. So there is this notion of independence between the cause and the mechanism, which is a kind of independence that's different from statistical independence that was promoted by Jansing and Sholkopf. And there is a challenge, and there are actually several challenges that were headed by Isabelle Guyon, where she collected, Isabelle Guyon and colleague collected a lot of pairs of correlated variables. And the challenge is just to say whether the first one causes the second one, or the second one causes the first one, or they're correlated because of a common cause. Three, just classify the situation. And the winning techniques typically are not techniques that use very complicated processes. They are techniques that just look at features of the joint distribution in more or less smart ways, of course, and try just to do classification, and that works. It's quite amazing. But this cause mechanism independence assumption is based on the idea that we don't believe in coincidences, even though we know that in some cases coincidence can happen by design when you have an equilibrium. So in the end, one has to look at a case of causal discovery that has been studied for centuries. It's a scientific method. There are books in epistemology about why it works, what should be done, and how to do it right. And the method is pretty simple. It's fine data that's fully described by the current model, which means some assumptions and some calculus. Postulate new causal relations that would fix the problem, and then verify with a variety of ad hoc experiments. And if I had 1 hour, I would go over 3 examples that I sort of like and show how what these people did connects to the various pieces that I've described before. In having a calculus of inference that can be accurate, by making it more accurate, you can discover that Neptune has a problem, Uranus, the orbit of Uranus has a problem, and you can move things. And you can postulate the existence of a new planet, but then you have to verify. The verification is a manipulation. If I point my telescope at the coordinates I've computed, I see something. And then there is the question of coincidences, you know, this informal knowledge that says that a coincidence between, in the case of cholera, for instance, so John Snow postulates that the cholera comes from spoiled water in London. And he investigates a place where there was a cholera outbreak. And among the observations he makes to justify that the spoiled water causes the cholera is that he questioned a lot of master brewers. Master brewers don't drink water, so they didn't get cholera, except one. And he asked his friends, he said, I don't know what took him, he just drank water that day. So how much do you believe that coincidence? And the argument of John Snow relies on how much do you believe this coincidence. And you can see the same for the tobacco versus cancer. You know, the statistics show that there is a positive correlation between smoking and having lung cancer. But yeah, maybe there is a gene that predisposes you to have cancer and also gives you the urge to smoke. You don't know. It could be a common cause. And then there is this argument that in some states, taxes on tobacco are higher, so the consumption is less and the lung cancer is less. And how much do you believe that this gene also causes the election of government who lower taxes on cigarettes? And this is a lot of informal knowledge about which assumptions we believe and how much we believe them, which coincidences we believe and how much we believe them. And at this point, I must say, I'd have no knowledge of a formal process that defines this very neatly. So I go to my conclusion. And a simple recap of a number of things. The causes and effects are the pieces of a calculus that allows us to predict the outcome of manipulations. That the observed correlations do not reliably reveal causal relations, and not even the direction, because of potential common causes that we cannot observe. that predicting the outcome of manipulation using existing data set is possible provided the data was collected with sufficient known, recorded, and documented randomization, which is quite an onerous requirement. You know, if you read the New York Times, they say you collect data from everywhere, you put it somewhere, you don't know how it's there, it's just there, and people are going to do magic. There is no magic. We need to know what kind of randomization was in it, how reliably it was there, reliably it was inserted in the system, and we need to know what the outcome of the dice was each time. And this is rarely recorded. In fact, in the case of the ad placement system, one of the first actions was to record all the random operations very carefully, and this is difficult to do very reliably, and this is very hard to debug. The fourth observation is that without a priori knowledge, discovering causal relations from observational data is essentially impossible. Right, that's it. And that the more we understand causes and effects in our data, the better we can predict the outcomes of manipulations, and the better we can discover new causal relations. And that's it. Yeah, two good questions. The relations between logic and statistics. We have this thing called probabilistic inference, which is a form of reasoning. Logic is another form of reasoning. It's richer. We also have natural language, which is an even finer form of reasoning, where we can write sentences and with sentences explain things to each other. And I see them just as different forms of reasoning with different powers. Like, for instance, first-order logic. Everything I write in first-order logic, I can explain with words. The converse is not true. First-order logic can do quite a lot of causation, but I have to add an extra business, which is this counterfactual business of Lewis. I can explain everything I do with probabilities in first-order logic. This is the axiomatic of probabilities. But the converse is not true, because first of all, correlations have symmetries that are enforced, that are not necessarily true when you have implications. So for me, this is the relation. Just different ways to reason. In the talk, I call them calculus, different ways to calculate things. And calculating things is important because of engineering. You know, we want to calculate things in order to predict what would happen and therefore decide what we will do. That's the first question. The second question, reinforcement learning. This is extremely connected. In reinforcement learning, basically, you have a causal model, which is the Markov decision process. You have the universe that has a state. You observe the universe. You decide an action. And the universe gets a new state, and so on. So it's a kind of dynamical system. You know that it's general enough that you can represent pretty much anything. But it's also nice if you know the fine causal structure, because then you can get better estimates. So the connection between this approach and reinforcement learning is that reinforcement learning is also a causation problem. It's a dynamical kind, which is one of the difficult ones. It typically works when the sequence of action is much longer than the state of the universe you assume, because otherwise you're in trouble. And typically, you don't make strong assumptions about the structure of the causal model that connects the successive states or the actions. If you look at the ad system, you could say have a state that represents what all users and all advertisers are thinking, and whenever I do something, I'm changing the state. But you know a lot of things about how you change the states. By leveraging this, you can get better estimates.